So let's start getting into the video series. Our first series starts with the basic introduction, like the terminologies and what are the differences, what are the various tools used, and what are the consumer and the producer model, and all those things we'll look into. And then we'll kickstart with the whistle and all those things. And then we'll be following up with installation and some more prerequisites, like our example, whistles, where to get it from, and then how to create an account for that thing. So basically, we'll be working out with two things, like calculator sample application and Salesforce application. So for Salesforce application, we need to have the login credentials and all those things. So that we'll see how to get those things as a prerequisite part. And then we'll go with the installation and the navigation of SOAP UI tool. So let's begin. So basically, before getting into understanding what the web services testing includes, what we basically require while we are doing a web service testing, we need to understand the functionality offered by the web services first, and then what the web service functionality is described by the whistle. So what the operations that are available, and what are the inputs that are that we need to pass it. Everything will be clearly defined in the whistle. So this is the very basic prerequisites for testing a web service. That is, SOAP-based web service, if you are testing, we need to get the whistle file from the developer and check in the whistle file, what are the available operations and what are the available parameters which we need to pass it, and whether they are optional or whether they are mandatory. And all these things will be clearly defined in the whistle file. So this is a whistle file is just like an interface which provides some information about the methods which were exposed. So this is all about the basic prerequisites which you need to have it at the very beginning of starting the web service, SOAP-based web services testing. And then we need to determine the XML request and the response format, how it was there, what are the parameters that were used, and all those things. And then we need to send a request, and then we need to validate, I mean the assertions we need to put up against the response, and check whether the request was sent and the response was received properly, and what the things we need to receive in the response. Like we need to get the what are the inputs we need to pass, and what are the response we need to get. These are the things we need to get from the development team, like the whistle file, request and response. What are the response for a specific request? What are the specific response we need to get it? Like if you're passing invalid parameters, so a specific response should be obtained in there. Like you need to say like this is not the proper format of the input that need to be followed, like that. If you are not giving any input, it is a mandatory, but you didn't provide any input. So it should say in a specific warning message indicating that it's a mandatory field and you need to pass the value. The value is missing, something of that sort. So these are all the basic things which we need to require, which you require before starting up with SOAP UI testing, I mean the SOAP web services testing. So these are the prerequisites we need to collect from the development team. Once this is done, so let's get into the topics of service-oriented architecture. So based on service-oriented architecture is basically the very beginning of the time. So let's see what this service-oriented architecture is all about and what really it concentrates about. So let's take a typical example of a, we can say like, assume like MakeMyTrip, and MakeMyTrip is utilizing some services from various flight operators like AirAsia, Deccan, etc. So who are the service providers and who is the consumer? So MakeMyTrip is the consumer who is consuming various responses from or various operations or various tests of data from various service providers like AirAsia, Deccan, etc. So who are the service providers? Service providers are like AirAsia. AirAsia is going to provide a whistle file. So he is going to say like, these are the requests, I mean these are the methods you need to utilize, or these are the operations you need to perform. You need to send us a request in order to get a particular response. So assume like you wanted the flights of AirAsia. So what AirAsia people will be doing is like, they will be exposing the whistles, or they will be exposing the REST APIs. So different things like assume like AirAsia might be built on top of Java or .NET, and assume like the Deccan is built on top of a .NET product, and AirAsia is built on top of Java product, and assume like make my trip is based on some other different programming language. So how is this communication being happening between three different programming languages? These applications built in different programming languages is all through XML. XML is a middleman, or JSON. JSON is a middleman, or the XML is a middleman who are going to interpret whatever language you send the request or the response, and they will be able to understand it. It's like assume like one person is in a typical example. Practical example is like one person coming from different state. Like assume a Telugu guy speaking to a Tamil guy. They cannot communicate directly until they know each other's language. So there should be some other medium. So English is a medium. Might be they both know English, and they will be able to communicate in English, and they will be understand each other. So XML or JSON is like English. And the programming language, different programming is like different language, Hindi, Malayalam, Tamil, Telugu. So they have a common medium, that is English. So every person, every programming language based application, different programming based application, language based applications are communicating in a common understandable language, that is XML or JSON, to communicate between different applications. So one application is providing the services, so they are called as service providers, and they are providing the services in the form of SOAP based or REST based. And the other guy who is consuming, he will be consuming based on the request, based on the service they're providing in the form of SOAP based or REST based. He will be consuming using the HTTP methods or using the SOAP based requests. So let's see all those in detail. So you can see this example over here. So example from one to one. So there is one service provider and there is one service consumer. So service provider is going to expose his methods for giving the, for example, like a make my trip is interacting with AirAsia to get the flight details. So the service consumer, make my trip, is going to send a request. Please send out the flight details from so and so time using the methods exposed by AirAsia. AirAsia will say, like, use this particular method, get flights. So what the service consumer make my trip will do is he'll hit the server of make my trip, AirAsia, with the request, with the resource. That is, the resource is like get flights. So he will use the URL with get flights method or operation, and then based on that, the service provider AirAsia will be sending out the response. So and so time, the flights are available. So that's the response will be sent out by AirAsia, and it will be consumed by make my trip. So assume a different scenario, like make my trip or Redbus or Abibus is having, they are going to swap all the flight details from different consumers, different providers. So the different service providers like AirAsia, Deccan, etc., Lufthansa, and all those things are providing the flight services. No, Redbus is consuming from different operators, Kaleshwari Travels or etc. Travels. They are consuming from various travel agents these bus tickets. So these are the service consumers. They're consuming the details from the service provider either through SOAP based request and responses or REST API based request and responses. So basically these are the two available protocols for communicating using APIs or web services. So API is a generalized term and web services is a narrow term. So let's get into other details. So this is the service-oriented architecture. Which is service-oriented architecture is nothing but a service provider and consumer, service provider and a consumer model. That is the service-oriented architecture is all about. So next, let's see. What are the steps involved in providing and consuming a service? So basically, when you are going to, what the service provider is going to do, the service provider like AirAsia is going to provide a visitor file I mean, it lists out all the services that will be provided by Air Asia, like flight details, flight charges, and other offers available on their sites will be displayed. So various methods will be there. Those methods will be exposed in the visual file. So these are the methods. These are the inputs you need to provide. If you format up in this format and then send it out, we'll be sending out the response for you. So this is, we'll be providing the service of the flights, our flights to you. So this is how they'll be formatting and they'll be exposing this digital file for the my trip. And then the service consumer, whatever he does is like he queries the service provider, means it hits the server of the service provider, make my trip, with this request. What is the request? Get flights. So this is what is happening. So next, let's see the service consumer. That's what I told, like we'll be utilizing the visitor file to send the request to the service provider, and the service provider provides the expected response based on the request he sends out. So let's see what basic protocols that are available for API development. So there are two main protocols, as I already explained. It is either implemented using SOAP based protocol or REST based protocol. So when you're implementing through SOAP based protocol, it is purely XML, no other format. When you're implementing through REST based protocol, it can support multiple formats. It can support XML, it can support JSON, etc. So what is the difference? So JSON is lightweight, so that's the reason REST is being much popular. But SOAP is much secure than REST. Why? Because there are so many additions in SOAP UI, so many things that provides an extra security over REST. So what it's all like, what happens in SOAP and what happens in REST? We'll be looking out how the communication happens with a clear pictorial representation. So before that, let's see what we are going to do for sending a request in SOAP and what we are going to do it in REST. While using REST, when sending REST, while sending a request to REST, what we use is like HTTP methods we'll use, and then like a common URL will be sending it out. HTTP request will be sending it out, and then we'll be getting the response. But in SOAP, we'll be formatting in a SOAP based format, and then we'll be sending out one XML request with all the whatever it was provided in the whistle. These are the requests formats which we need to frame, and then we need to send out in the SOAP based format. There is a specific format we'll be looking at. Then just next, let's see the pictorial representation of how the communication happens using the SOAP based request, JSON based request, and also the REST based request. Before that, let's see what is the whistle and what is the UDDI, etc. So what are the abbreviation for whistle is like Web Services Description Language. So the name is the name itself says it describes what the web service contains. What the web service? What are the services provided by this particular whistle or this particular web service? So it's, you can read out from here. It's like it's an XML format. Whistle is an XML format describing network service as a set of endpoints operating on the messages. Messages are nothing but the inputs, and set of endpoints are nothing but the resource points, which are called as the methods which are going to hit on the particular server. The operations in the messages are described abstractly. As I told, Visual is an interface which defines what are the methods, what are the inputs that need to provide for the methods operations, and how to work on the how to work on this to get the response, expected response. And they are bound to a specific protocol. As I told, the protocol is SOAP based or REST based. So what UDDI is? UDDI is abbreviates like Universal Description, Discovery, and Integration. So it's platform independent, and it's a XML based registry, and it's exposed on the web. It's like, assume like one of the organization is having some application which can be utilized by some other applications. They wanted to put it universally, or they wanted to convey that these are the features that we are going to provide. You can utilize or consume these APIs. excuse me, these APIs. So some are publicly public visitors will be there, and some people, they don't want it to give it free of cost, and they will be charging out. So what they will be doing is like they will be putting it out in the public registries like UDDA or something, or any other registries where someone who wants a particular service or a particular kind of features, they'll be searching through the UDDA, and then they will be consuming, or they will be contacting the particular, if they are not publicly exposed, then they will be contacting the particular vendor, and they'll be getting the permission, and they'll be charged, and then they'll be utilizing those systems, those APIs, for integrating within their application. So you can see in the diagrammatic representation, publisher is the organization which is going to publish the information regarding to the API, and the user is a consumer who wants this information. He searches the UDDA registry and gets the information, and he speaks to the publisher. If it is not public, it is private. Public, I mean, it's a private. It is not going to allow it for free of cost. So at that point of time, user needs to communicate to the publisher, and then you need to get the permission, you need to get the API authentications to be utilized in his application. And this is all about UDDA and this stuff. And let's get into Excel about Excel and JSON. And some other terms like the endpoints, URI, URL. What is the URL? So you can see in this basic diagrammatic representation, everything is clear. The user searches for the UDDA registry for a particular API or a particular service, and then he gets, if it is available, if it is provided by some service provider, it will be available in the registry. If he exposes in the registry, it will be available in the registry, and that he can get the digital, and he can utilize in his particular, the user can utilize in his particular application. So what basically the basic terms like URI, endpoint, and all those things. So URI is nothing but it contains the server address and the resource path on the server address. That is a URI. So what URL is like, the server address where you need to get the response from. If you hit that particular server, you get the response. That is a URL. The location where the services are deployed is the URL. On the server which where they are deployed is a URL. And the path to that location, path to that service where this service is available on the particular server is URN. So URI is a combination of URL followed by URL. And let's see what is XML and JSON. So XML, as I spoke, like it's an extensible markup language. It is used for interoperable communication between different applications. And JSON is also similar, but it is JavaScript object notation. It is in the form of JavaScript object notation. And it is being much popular these days, and is structured in a particular format. And it is an alternative to XML, and REST API is most commonly used JSON. Also it used XML, but it was on the hype. JSON is on the hype because of its lightweight structure. And everything is arranged in the form of a key value pairs. So that's all about JSON and XML. And let's get into the pictorial representation for communication over using the SOAP-based protocols and REST-based protocols and JSON-based, how it is formatted and everything. So just we can have an overview of how the communication is formatted using SOAP protocol. As I explained, when the request is being sent, it was sent in the form of this kind of format. Assume like guest customer information, get customer information, is the method or the operation that is supported, and it was being exposed by the service provider in the visual file. And the service consumer, he formats it in the form of SOAP based request, and he wanted to get the get customer information with the account number as this one. And with this SOAP based format request, he sends it to the service provider. And the service provider, based on this inputs from the service consumer, he provides the expected response. So even the expected response is an XML. So as I told, SOAP is purely based on XML. So now let's get into communication using how the communication is happening and how it is formatted, request and response is formatted in REST-based APIs. So REST-based APIs, as I told, the request will be gone in form of using the HTTP methods like get method or post method or delete method, etc., etc. So you can see clearly it was in this format. The request you had been framed like the endpoint with the URL followed by the resource path and the parameters. Parameter is like the account number, this parameter is, and the parameter is passed. So at this resource path, I mean in this database, assume in this database, search for account number 1069 and give me the result. That's what he passed from the consumer to the service provider. Service provider, what he does is like he triggers the query and he sends the response with the account number, all the information of the account number 1069 in XML format. So this is if the service provider is accepting only XML format, then you need to send it in the form of content will be outputted in the form of XML. So if the service provider is accepting JSON, we can see how it gets formatted. The request will be in the form of the same way, but the response will be formatted in the form of JSON. You can see, just leave that JSON part, post and all those things, the request. The response part, the request part will be the same as before. But the response part, you can see it will be formatted in the key value pairs. This is the JSON format. So this is how we'll be getting the response, the JSON notation. So this is all the basic parts. This is all the things we need to learn about, I mean the basic terminologies and all those things. So now let's get hands-on into, I mean, installation part and the example, what is it, Salesforce application, creation and creation of an account for the Salesforce application and all those things. We will do the prerequisites first and then get into hands-on on the practical sessions next. So let me just navigate back. So this is basically the download link, just click on it. So you can click on, just get it, and you will be getting the particular version of it. If you wanted a different platform, and then you can select a different platform, and then you can download it. Just click on get it. And it will be downloaded. So that based version, if you wanted a different version, you can just choose alternative location, alternative. So just if you click on this one, you will be navigated to that particular location where you get the download link. Once you get this, you can just click on alternative platforms if you wanted to download it for different versions. Windows, Linux, Mac, or if you wanted a 64-bit version of it, you can select it and you can download it from here. Once this is done, basically I was not explaining the installation part. It's just next part. As I already installed SOAP UI in my system. And then the other prerequisites is like, since we'll be working mostly with a calculator based application, let's see where to get the result from the calculator for the calculator based application. So just go to Google and search for calculator Vista. It's fully exposed. You can get the calculator web services from here, DNA online. And if you go to the service description, this is where, I mean the visual description, web service description. So this is where we'll get that one. So this is all. Just copy this link. Copy that link. And save it. So let me just make a note of it. So this is the calculator wisdom. And similarly, we have a Salesforce wisdom, and I just don't have the particular path where to get it from on the net, and I'll be just storing it in my cloud, Google Cloud, and then I'll be just putting the part in that video URL, and you can download it from there directly. It's very important when we are working with the Salesforce application. So now let's get on to creating an account for the Salesforce. These are all prerequisites before starting up with our videos on the next. So let me get it. So just navigate to this particular URL, and then you will have a sign up place. Just click on sign up over there, and you need to fill up all the information. And once you fill up the information, you will be getting a link to authenticate whether it was a valid user or not. And once you get the mail ID and verify the account, and then you need to generate a security token. So how to generate a security token? Just navigate to this particular, once you have created and verified the account, just navigate to this particular URL and hit this one. So hit this one. Let me log in. You should be logged in before that. And once you done it, you will be asked to reset the token, security token. Once you click on reset security token, a new token will be sent out to your mail. So let me just log into my mail. So we received it. So this is the token. So just save the username, password, and the token and all those details. It is very important when we are working. When we are working practically. So these are the things we need to do it. And once we saved it, the outcome of these things is like we'll be having the username and password to log into the Salesforce account and the security token. So these are the things we need to utilize while hitting the server, Salesforce server. And then there are some other digital files to work on, like the country related web services. And then we are seeing the calculator and Salesforce. As I told, I'll mention it in the Google Drive. I'll place it in the Google Drive and I'll share the link for that. When we start working on that. So that's all. One more thing I want to mention is just the navigations I want to show up before ending this thing. So once we install the SOAP UI, we'll be having a clear thing without any projects or anything. So this is the basic UI we'll be having. So let me just navigate to all the things like file. You can see like you can create new SOAP project from here. And you can import the project from here, existing project if you're having, you can import from here. And every time when you are making some changes or if you're having something done, please save all the projects. Click on save all the projects. Control Alt S is a shortcut. If you don't save it, we'll be losing everything because these things are not synced with the cloud. As it happens in the Postman and all those things, it doesn't happen in here. Once, if the SOAP UI even stuck out, and it is not responding, every work which is unsaved will be lost. So please ensure that any work it was done was saved. And then you can see, you can do the same thing. You can create an empty project from here, or you can create a soap-based project from here. You can project, you need to provide over here the project name and the whistle here, and then click on OK, and the project with the particular whistle will be created over there. And if you wanted to import, you can import from here the particular whistle for the particular project. And one more thing I wanted to tell you is like the preferences. You can navigate to the preferences from here, and global properties are one of the things which we'll be talking of. So this is the area where the global properties will be saved, and we can navigate to it in another way. File, preferences, so global properties. So this is all. So this is the basic navigation and all those things. And also you can see like here we'll be having the properties that we'll be looking at it a bit later. So this is all. This is all the basic navigation, installation, and all the basics of SOAP UI. So we are ready with everything, the prerequisites, basic knowledge, basic understanding on everything related to SOAP and REST-based, the different protocols used in the service-oriented based architecture. So that's all. Thank you.